Hi, welcome to Peaceworks, and I'm Heather Gallion. In this episode, we're going to hear from Janell Anema, and we asked some people the following question. What should be our top priority? Being good citizens of our country or good citizens of the kingdom of God?
Well, definitely depends on if you're a Christian or not, right? But as Christians, I think the Bible's pretty clear, and hopefully our churches are teaching this too, to actually that our number one calling is the kingdom of God, obviously. Then I think it's Paul talks a little bit about how we're kind of resident aliens. We're kind of like, we're people who, we're living here, but we're not actually of this kingdom. So I think probably most Christians would agree that the kingdom of God, or you hear a lot of Christians say, as long as follow the laws of the land, unless those laws go against God or bring you something that's saying like counter-Christian or something like that, then don't follow those laws of the land. But other than that, follow the laws of the land. That's how I was kind of raised. That's what my parents said. So, but I think that's something that kind of kicks it up a whole nother gear, is that we need to be looking at a lot more than just the standout values of, say, war or something like that, or should I not go to war or should I not, but there's actually all these smaller values that we should probably be a lot more countercultural on, and kingdom values, whether it's how much stuff we own, whether it's what kind of vehicles we drive, or how we interact with our neighbors, and how situations around like greed and about self-preservation and all those kind of areas that you know, the country, our country might have certain kind of values on, that the value of what success is might look like this. But for a Christian, for a kingdom value, it may look completely differently. And that's something I think in smaller means, we actually have to be challenging ourselves on following the kingdom rather than following the country, right? And that most Christians would say following the kingdom is probably a better value, but in those little tiny details, they're probably following the country a lot more than the kingdom, right?
Well, if you're a good citizen in the kingdom of God, then you're a good citizen to your country, because when you're being a good citizen to the kingdom of God, it means you're following what God's saying, you're trying to steer everybody on the right path, and through that, then you're helping your country out too. So being a good citizen to the kingdom of God should be your top priority, which leads into being a good citizen to your country.
Good citizens of the kingdom of God should be our top priority. Should be pretty straightforward. It's all written in the Bible. Put God first in your life, and just doing that can make a huge difference on being a good citizen in your country.
I think that they're both important, because being a good citizen in your country, in a way, is being a good citizen of the kingdom of God, and just presenting yourself that way.
Because a perfect, I think, example of someone who is following the kingdom rather than the culture is Jesus himself, right? And when we look to Jesus, he was kind of a weirdo. Like, he wasn't normal, right? It wasn't like he was average. He was drastically different in so many different ways. And so if we're looking to him as the prime example, we should be kind of seen as weirdos a little bit, you know, in this world. So that's how we follow the kingdom rather than the country. But, yeah.
Let's see what some others had to say about that.
Thank you. I consider myself to be a writer more than anything. And so anytime I'm asked to share a reflection or a thought about a particular topic, I have to write it down. So I'm going to be reading some of those reflections here with you today when it comes to the conversation about peacemaking and nonviolence. For most of my life, pacifism or nonviolence was usually treated like a minority position. It was just an add-on to personal holiness, and it wasn't a fundamental commitment of faith. I came to this theology of nonviolence later in life because I had this faith as a child that was fundamentally tied to a sense of patriotic justice. I had a militaristic faith. My practices were regimented and ritualistic. I was in the Lord's army, and I loved it. My Christianity was inextricably linked to a nationalistic pride. I was justified by faith, and America was justified in war. I believed that there was such a thing as necessary violence. I worshipped with a view of a vengeful Christ, the Jesus that turned over tables in the temple, the warmonger God of the Old Testament. And there wasn't ever any fear or concern or critical thinking about that view of God because I was on the right side. Like I said, I was in the Lord's army, and we were always winning. That side was wealthy and comfortable and Republican and conservative. And then September 11th happened, and my understanding of violence and the way that my faith interacted with an international community radically shifted. And then I moved to Liberia, a small country in West Africa, and worked with victims of war and former child soldiers. I was given a handful of books by John Howard Yoder. I began to learn about the life of Dorothy Day. I brought the papers and the sermons of Martin Luther King with me when I would get on the train in the morning. And suddenly, I had an entirely new lens with which to view the Sermon on the Mount. And the Jesus of the Gospels invaded my perceptions of this vengeful Christ. I learned about a different side that God might be on, the side of the meek and the poor, the side of the humble and the hungry. The least and the last, those were the ones that Jesus spoke about. If anything, he reserved judgment for those regimented and ritualistic Pharisees, and my faith represented more of their actions than those that I saw Jesus inviting to come close to him. So I've spent the last 10 years since that September morning readjusting my lifestyle, my relationships, even my very spiritual language to build relationships with those people that he taught us to love and to serve. To know the power of his resurrection, to participate in his sufferings, even becoming like him, somehow attaining life through death. I'm compelled, because of my understanding of who Jesus is, to be in relationship now with the poor, with the needy, with the widow, with the orphan, to lay down my sword, to die that I might live. And because I believe and I saw that those practices are reflected in the life of Jesus, I believe that we're meant to live that way. Since he commands us to do those things, then we must, if we follow him, act the same. And as we live out that gospel that's both saving and social, we reveal an understanding of Christ. But if we call ourselves followers of Jesus and we don't engage in any of those relationships or discipline ourselves in those practices, it's because we must imagine that those practices don't say anything about the very nature of God. I'm not sure why, but when it comes to the conversations about violence, that same logic doesn't seem to apply to the public discourse. People, governments, my own churches seem to talk about self-defense and the necessity of war, and it seems like being a Christian suddenly has nothing to do with imitating the life of a radical Christ. If how we live is supposed to be intertwined with what we claim about Jesus, then matters revolving around war and self-defense and survival are of utmost importance. Whether or not we decide to employ violence in order to protect ourselves or our loved ones or our neighbors is certainly a matter of concern for those of us who follow an executed criminal who was killed by his own enemies. We know that there's no redemptive violence. Redemption is only attained through Christ's resurrection. So if we decide to resort to violence, we're clearly saying something about what we believe to be true about the Prince of Peace. As Christians, we get the opportunity to testify to God's care and His providence that offers the world an alternative to the violence that we see around us. The kingdom of God is breaking into human history today. And while nations make war, the people of God, we, the people of God, have an opportunity to embody an alternative. And the mission of the church, then, is to serve as an outpost. Our sermons should be a clarion call to a peaceable kingdom. More than this, our pacifism might just witness to the fact that God will act and does act in every situation. And we can trust that the ways that God will act are going to be consistent with the life of Jesus of Nazareth. Nonviolence isn't just about pacifism. It's persuading people around us that another world is possible. And the more time I spend in scriptures, the more that I'm led to believe that God's heart is a heart for peace. I love the picture of peace in the book of Revelation, chapters 21 and 22, that talk about the new heaven and the new earth. John has that vision of the new heaven and new earth because the first had ceased to exist and the sea was no more. He saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, descending out of heaven from God, made ready like a bride adorned for her husband. And he heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Look, the residence of God is among his people. He'll live with them and they'll be his people, and God himself will be with them. He'll wipe away every tear from their eyes, and death won't exist anymore. Mourning, crying, pain, the former things have ceased to exist." And then the angel showed him the river of life. The water was as clear as crystal, and it poured from the throne of God and the Lamb. It was flowing down the middle of the city's main street, and on each side of the river is the tree of life that produces 12 different kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month of the year. And the leaves of those trees offer healing to nations. Every tribe, every tongue, every nation, everyone, God's church is a peace church. And Christianity must faithfully witness to Christ, and to represent him, we must proclaim that gospel of peace. But what does that look like in me? I understand that a church isn't simply a building with a steeple. It's a body comprised of many members, and one of those members is me. We're the people of God. We're members of this kingdom. We're a part of the body of Christ. I am the church. So each week when I gather with the flawed and the faithful women and men that compose my congregation, or when I gather in my neighborhood, or when I sit here in my very living room. Sometimes we sing that song, "When peace like a river attendeth my soul, and when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, you've taught me to say, it's well with my soul." I love that. I love that hope of peace. Whatever my lot, in the midst of sorrow, in the face of whatever is formidable or forgotten or forsaken, peace. I desire peace in the world. I desire for every nation to be free from the ravages of war, from systematic rape, from genocide. Peace. I desire peace in the church, for every church to be free from violence and abuse among congregations and among families. Peace. I desire peace in me, for my very thoughts to be released from all that rages in me, because the same sermon that blesses the meek and honors the poor tells me that if I say raka to my brother and if I say fool to my sister, then my penalty is the same as if I've taken their very lives. But I'd rather think about peace in a song and nonviolence as a theory than a viable theology of how I ought to live my life. Because while it's relatively easy to adhere to the thou shalt not murder commandment, it's incredibly difficult for me to live with a nonviolent heart. So I ask the questions daily: what is a process of disarmament in me? How does the Prince of Peace resonate in Janelle? How is the peaceable Christ reflected in my very words and deeds? Honestly, not very well most days. I love the story of Jesus told in John chapter 8, where Jesus comes to the temple courts to teach, and he's interrupted by the Pharisees who've brought a woman who's been caught in sexual sin. I can only imagine how tightly they gripped her, her shoulders exposed, her sin exposed, as she tries to gather her clothes around her. The crowd is seething with a lust for punishment, and they say to Jesus, "Teacher, we found this woman caught in the act. The law of Moses demands that we stone her to death. What do you have to say?" You can guess that the rocks are already in their fists. that they filled their pockets, ready to take revenge. Jesus says nothing. Instead, he bends down to the earth, and he dirties his fingers, and begins to absorb the focus of the venomous crowd. "Have you nothing to say?" they mock. Jesus stops and looks at them. "Why don't you without sin, cast the first stone?" And he kneels back down, returns to the dirt, grounded. Slowly the rocks begin to fall to that same ground, consequences of a loosened fist, of an opened hand. The crowd is dismantled when confronted with Jesus, and he's left alone with the woman. Again, he stops writing in the dirt and he looks at her. "Woman, is there no one left to condemn you? Then neither do I. Go and leave your life of sin." Do you see how Christ models an interruption to violence in this scenario? How he redirects the rage of the crowd, he absorbs it on himself, and then he confronts them with their own sin. And the only thing that the woman is left exposed to is grace. Some days it's really easy for me to identify with the woman in this story. She's powerless. She's been victimized. She's vulnerable. Certainly, she's made poor choices. But she's surrounded in this moment at the mercy of a crowd. She's threatened. And I've been threatened. I've been the vulnerable one. I've been harassed. I've been followed home from the train. I've been catcalled. I've been verbally assaulted. And I dare not catch the eye of strangers most days, lest I invite any kind of unwanted attention. And I'm not the only one. Other women in my neighborhood, the women that I worked with in Liberia, people who work in what are considered the rougher parts of town. I've been in countries where women are abused regularly with no repercussions. There's no recourse. There are literally no rape laws on the books. And each day, I hear violence explode between mothers and children as small girls are screamed at and small boys are slapped. And each day, I see violence between the police officers and the hustlers outside of the train station. And in those moments, I find that I'm picking up stones in my heart. And some days when I'm followed home from the train as I walk in the dark, I find that I have literally picked up stones and I carry them in my pocket, inviting somebody to come too close to me. As I'm catcalled, as I'm followed, as I'm leered at and groped, I pick up stones. I clench them in my fist. I'm ready to respond to the violence that I see around me. I react with violence that's in me. I carry those stones, I turn them around in my fingers, and when I'm most human, I am craving a fight. I almost hope that someone will touch me so that I can respond, so that I can rage. Dr. King tells us that returning hate for hate only multiplies hate. He says that it adds deeper darkness to a night that's already devoid of stars. Darkness can't possibly drive out darkness. Only light does that. Hate can't drive out hate, only love does that. And it's been said that people who go to war begin to resemble their enemies, that violence doesn't resolve, it only leads to more violence. And each day when I try to combat the violence that I experience out of my humanity, I find that I'm no longer just a victim, I'm a perpetuator, I'm a perpetrator, and it poisons me. I like to sing songs about peace like a river on Sunday mornings, but I find that I am like a tea, too long steeped in a culture of rage, too long steeped in a culture of violence. The anger, it boils, it screams in me, and my fists are clenched so tightly. At the end of most days, I find that I no longer identify with the woman in John chapter 8, but I find that I identify with the Pharisees, ready to cast those stones. How can my heart be disarmed? Where is the Prince of Peace in those moments? I'm not saying that female pacifism in particular is meant to promote passivity and victimization. There has to be a third way. There can't be those two options of either becoming a victim or taking vengeance that doesn't belong to me. In that very space, in the tightness of my fist, I must invite the Christ of the cross, the Prince of Peace, to quiet me, to enfold me, to hold me. And as I offer that invitation, as I pray, some days I find that I've unclenched my fist. And I offer an open hand to the Father and an upturned palm to my neighbor. And maybe someday I'll even offer an open hand to my enemy. I pray like David did, God, you're my God. Earnestly I seek you, I thirst for you. My whole being longs for you. In a dry and weary land where there's no water, I've seen you in the sanctuary and beheld your power and your glory. And because your love is better than life, my lips will glorify you. I'll praise you as long as I live, and in your name I will lift up my open hands. I'll be fully satisfied as with the richest of foods, and with singing lips, my mouth will praise you. On my bed, I remember you. I think of you through the watches of the night because you are my help, and I sing in the shadow of your wings. I cling to you. Your hands uphold me. And those who want to kill me will be destroyed. They'll go down to the depths of the earth and be given over to the sword and become food for jackals. But I will rejoice in God. All who swear by God will glory in him, and the mouths of the liars will be silenced. Injustice is offensive and pervasive, and anger in me is a sign that I'm paying attention. Anger itself, though, becomes a sign of impotence, a resignation to powerlessness if it isn't disciplined into an expression of love. Anger is natural in its response to injustice, but it has to be transformed into something else. I really think that anger is simply frustrated love. A love of peace, of shalom, of that wholeness, that harmony within myself, that once it overflows might just impact my community, my land, my enemy. That vision of shalom is what I long for. It's what enlivens my faith. It's the thing that I come back to at the end of every day, and it's what compels me to get up in the morning and to get back on the train, to go back to that neighborhood, to participate in ushering a new kingdom. Ours must be a faith that's in progress. This is a journey. It's a sanctification. And nonviolence is a discipline, and it's a discipline of love toward a path of peace. Our practice of nonviolence is just that. It's a practice. It's non-negotiable. It requires continual reflection. And some days I get it wrong. And thankfully, Christ still meets me in that. And so I labor on. So we labor on. Dostoevsky, he says that it's not as a child that I believe and confess that Jesus is Christ. My Hosanna is born of a furnace of doubt. And for me, the conversation about peacemaking and nonviolence is being purified in that same furnace of doubt. Of course, our faith will live in a furnace of doubt as we experience the pain and suffering of those around us. When bad things happen to good people, when wars ravage nations and addictions ravage our neighbors, in the face of tyranny and injustice, in the midst of rape and abuse. And when we doubt, I sincerely believe that when we're confounded and when we're bewildered and undone, that God is there. In the prose of David and the poems of Emily Dickinson, in the face of that tyranny, God is there. And in that space between poetry and prose, our soul expands and deepens. Nonviolence births hope, and hope rises. Because hope is the thing of feathers that perches in the soul, and sings the tune without the words and never stops at all. And sweetest in the gale is heard, and sore must be the storm that could abash that little bird that kept so many warm. I've heard it in the chillest land and on the strangest sea, but never in extremity did it ask a crumb of me. That hope and love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and even self-control, that fruit of the Spirit is available to us. And as we live into the fruit of the Spirit, as we live into the characteristics of God, as we usher in a new kingdom where the Prince of Peace is securely on the throne, hope rises. Martin Luther King Jr., as he closes out one of the letters that he's written that addresses the brokenness in our criminal justice systems and in our congregations, in our homes and in us, He says, let us pray and hope that the light of God will shine in our situation so that in the not too distant future, we will be able to emerge from the bleak and desolate midnight of man's inhumanity to man into the bright and glittering daybreak of freedom and justice. And I can't say it better. Amen. Amen.
Morning dress, if it ever made a mess.